About the file sharing on page 2, I mentioned a little bit about this war that's going on. It's quite interesting because what's happening now is the entertainment industries are faced with the problem of the demand is outstripping the supply, if you will. That up until very recently, they could strictly control the distribution of media, physical media, DVDs, CDs, television programs through licensing, when and where they can air with permission. So if a television program aired in the US, for example, people had to wait a year, 2 years until the DVD would come out in an Australian edition or an edition somewhere else. So they maintain strict control through coding the DVDs with regions. So if you bought a DVD in Europe, you couldn't play it in the US, etc. They had the knowledge locked up in that way. But what has happened with the increase of internet access to higher bandwidth, etc., new advances in coding and compression of audio-video materials has enabled people to basically record something from television and make it available the next morning globally. And it completely undermined the entire distribution mechanism that the entertainment industries had on media. Now, that's an interesting point in and of itself, but what's fascinating to me is that all of this is, this war is really about access to the latest Hollywood movies. So the irony is the global addiction that the world seems to have to Hollywood movies is eventually going to bring down the entertainment industry, which had a lock on media. That doesn't involve us directly. I don't think we're talking here about who's going to get to watch Avatar first, but that's what it's about. I mean, there actually is a war going on now, and there are serious implications for this war. To me, this war is about the outdated business model that the entertainment industries have that is based on making their money from physical media. They have not been able to come up with a business model that can fully embrace this free circulation of information. In fact, what's beginning to emerge now is the only business model that they seem to be promoting now is litigation. So there's a lawsuit going on in the US where one of the latest Hollywood movies that was shared on the internet, they got 3,000 ISP identification numbers from people that were sharing that, and they're trying to get a court to force the internet service provider to link those ID numbers with people's names, addresses, and telephone numbers so that then they can subpoena those people for illegal distribution of this media and serve them with lawsuits. That's a serious precedent that could possibly be set that's related to privacy and all of this. So all the privacy groups are up in arms about this. Again, it's about a Hollywood movie, so it doesn't really, but to me, it sets the climate, okay? There's a crisis going on now in distribution and access to media. We're not directly involved with the Hollywood stuff, but nevertheless, the outcome of this crisis will affect, I think, the things that we're interested in. Whether it leads to a further lockdown of the internet or a complete opening up of the internet remains to be seen, but those are the kinds of things that are at stake. Very recently, an entrepreneur has decided to further this business model of litigation by buying up all of the rights to as many news stories and databases as he possibly can from the mainstream as well as the fringe, anything he can get his hands on. He's buying the rights to all of these, and his business model is to trawl the internet for people who have cut and paste from these news stories onto their blogs and serve them with litigation. The way the litigation works is you'll get a letter that will say, we've noticed that you're illegally sharing this material, blah, blah, blah. There are serious implications, FBI, $200,000. They threaten you with all this, and then the bottom says, but you can avoid all this if you pay $200. It doesn't hold up in court, but their business model is that even if 10% of the people are scared enough to send that $200 without checking with a lawyer. They'll make money. So that's the only business model that the industry has been able to come up with, is litigation. There are interesting things happening with independent media producers and music groups that are trying to bypass the industry, trying to bypass all of that stuff, and that's worth looking at as well. But I don't want to belabor the point. The main issue here is that things are changing. The advances in technology has really posed a major challenge to this question of copyright, distribution, and access to knowledge. There's also access, you know, the question of third world access to expensive media. The Hollywood industries thought up another scheme that a lot of the piracy of their latest films was coming out of Russia. People didn't want to pay $30 for a DVD. They could just share it on the internet. So they came up with a scheme. They created a new region for the impoverished world, that it's Region 5. Region 1 is United States, North America. Region 2 is Europe and Japan. They put a little piece of code at the beginning of the DVD that says you can only play that in if your player is encoded with that region. They created a new region for the poor people called Region 5, so you can buy the latest Hollywood movies for the equivalent of about $5. But those are not marketed in North America and Europe and Japan, which are still stuck paying $40 to $50 for that. Of course, what happened was the Russians just took those cheaper ones and made those available also on the internet, so it kind of backfired. But this is just to give you some survey of what's been happening with all of this. But that raises a good question. Hollywood did identify the problem that the media cost too much. If we offer it at a cheaper price, maybe we'll eliminate the problem of piracy. That's a viable possible solution, but they didn't anticipate what would happen. This has implications for us. For example, there's a documentary that I wanted to use in one of my courses in Japan that was made by Wang Bing, a Chinese filmmaker who has profiled the emerging rust belt in the early parts of industrialized China. There's an emerging rust belt in southern China. He profiled that whole thing and the decay of these massive factories and the implications that it has on workers. It's really an amazing piece of work. He turned that over to a documentary distribution company in the USA that you have to pay $1,000 to get this DVD. Of course, Japan is a rich country, so I asked the library to buy it, and I even had to defend it in front of the budget committee because that was a lot of money to spend on one DVD, but they allowed it and they bought it. But who else can afford that? If you're not affiliated with an institution that can afford $1,000, then you'll never be able to see that film, number one. And the irony is it's made in China. It pertains directly to some of the things that are important for third world peoples, but it's not being made available to them. It's only being sold in the US for very high prices. So these distributors aren't trying that cheap access route. They're putting their future on the rich countries to sustain them, but that kind of leaves us out. So there are questions that are raised around this access, the monetary, the market, the inability of the market to provide the supply that is apparently there. There's a demand there, and also the inability of the market to adjust itself based on the means that people may have to pay for this kind of stuff, right? The people that are sharing Avatar and Michael Jackson and Madonna, they've all set up their own servers exclusive of YouTube and all these other things that are based in places where the copyright laws are shady, right? And there's a cat and mouse game going on now between the authorities that might close down a server in Sweden because the US government pressured the Swedish government to take the Pirate Bay offline, for example. No big deal, they found places that they can set up their servers in countries that are not as subservient or liable to pressure from the US, or that don't have as strict copyright laws. Mininova, was served with all these takedown notices because they were making available Hollywood material. So they eliminated all that material, but they entered into business arrangements with independent producers who are now airing and making their works available on BitTorrent willingly because they see it as a viable advertising. And Vandana mentioned this also, that, okay, if 100 people pirate your work, it's likely, and there are statistics that show that a certain percentage of those will buy that work as well, or they'll tell other people who will buy it. So some content producers are coming around to the realization that file sharing could also be a form of marketing rather than just lost revenue. We have to support those people that are doing open access. So I'm working with Pratik. I'm basically donating time and money to translating and making available Pretext videos, which are only in Spanish, to a broader audience. And I've been discussing with them about this. As I said, I hire my students to make English subtitles. Then I put those on the TV channel and then send those subtitles to the media people at Pretech, and then they then add them to the DVDs and make those available to broader audiences. Why not do that with other languages as well, if we think it's valuable for people around the world to see what Pretech is doing, for example? Then subtitling is a viable option there. But in any case, we have to support those people that are already making their work available on an open access basis. Pretech puts on all of their DVDs, if you like this work, please feel free to share it. They don't have any claims of that being prohibited for copying and sharing. They encourage people to do that. We should support the ones that are doing that. There are intermediary ways of doing this that use, for example, Creative Commons licensing and other types of things. We can explore that kind of stuff, but I think we have to support especially these NGOs and other groups that are perhaps what, sympathetic or kindred with multiversity, by helping them to distribute, to produce, to subtitle or whatever their works. There's an Argentinian filmmaker who died recently. In fact, I think he was at UCLA for a while. His name is Jorge Preloran. Remember him? He died 2 or 3 years ago. The Argentinian filmmaker in exile from Argentina got a job in UCLA making documentary films, but his previous work is really interesting. He did oral history type documentaries where he first recorded a narrative from his subject. He specialized in biographies. He recorded an audio narrative in the voice of his own subject. One that comes to mind is Hermógenes Cayo, who was a imaginero, someone who carved iconic images for folk Christianity. He wanted to tell his life story. He recorded the audio of that person's life, narrating his own life in his own voice, and then he filmed scenes, cut the film to the narrative, and made a documentary about this person's life. Very interesting. When he went to UCLA, he took that and gave it to Robert Gardner, a famous American documentary filmmaker, who overdubbed English and re-edited it a little bit and made it available for an English-speaking audience on DVD. To me, that reduces the charm and interest of this because it's no longer in the subject's own voice. They overdubbed this English voice. But the point is that that material is now locked up by copyright. No one can access that material. Before he died, he bequeathed his whole collection of films to the Smithsonian Institute, which doesn't seem to be doing anything with it. So if you want to watch those films, you have to go to the Smithsonian. I had heard that a company called Documentary Educational Resources is going to make the collected works of Jorge Preloran available on DVD. When, we don't know. It'll be for sure overdubbed in English, which destroys the real beauty of his work because he used the voice of his subjects. But second, it'll be locked up. That's the same company that has Wang Bing's DVDs for $1,000. Now, I found a media collective in Argentina that is reviving the original Spanish versions of Jorge Preloran's films and releasing those freely on the internet.